Ellie makes it a point to be obsessed with the origins of people, and so it makes me think about like nature versus nurture and how people grow up. Because even when he goes back to
what's your thought on the monster's nurture? Like, did he, I mean, first of all, is he evil? And then second of all, was he born that way, or was he kind of nurtured into that?
So, if you would have asked me at the beginning of chapter 11, I would have said he's definitely evil, but by the end of chapter 17, I mean, if you would have asked me at like chapter 13, I'd be like, no, he's definitely not evil, he's just a little obsessive or weird. But at the end of chapter 17, it's like, so the answer is I don't know, but I thought it was interesting how like through the chapters we see childhood slash he describes his senses a little bit, and he is really positive and hopeful, and then he discovers feelings, good and bad, so that's kind of nice. And then he figures out that he's different from humans, and so he's kind of like separating those distinctions, and then he's first becoming like obsessive, and then he's even more self-aware. And I think it's in here when he becomes obsessive and he finds out what it means to be human that he starts to hate himself. And one could argue it's when he first discovers his feelings, stuff, whatever. And then that's where the blame is contemplated, which I think is also a big part of being human, is placing blame. And then, I don't know.
Do we have to go in order? Do you like skip around?
Well, I guess if we could not skip around too much, so we can stick on this. Stick to it.
Well,
talk.
I was going to talk about like how Frankenstein learned to like their language, like from the people and the villains, like their language and how to read. And I was going to read the passage, but should I wait until we get to
that? Let me hold on to that, because mentioned the idea of self-awareness. I guess I would ask the question, how and when does the monster become self-aware?
Of what he is?
I
think right off of then. Sort of. Because, like, he sees the person who created him, like, run away in fear. So I think he's starting to, like, that's where he started to feel self-aware that he's, like, really different. And then when he goes into the house with the like villager eating his food, and then the villager sees him and then like runs away in fear, then I think that's when he became like fully aware that like that he's different, and like all the humans are gonna be terrified of him because he's not human.
Can I ask you a question? Or is that like okay? So did he have any human interaction between him like going out and then living in the forest area and then his creation, like other than Frankenstein, did he think he was like that just because like he fell out of place because he didn't know anything. So
yeah.
Like you see these people interacting, yet you can't interact with them.
Yeah.
So I don't think he was scared because he was scared to be shunned. He was scared because he didn't know what to do.
He's scared because his past, interaction. Yeah.
And before he goes to the huddle.
Yeah.
Before he goes there, he does.
He runs into a giant village.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's people freak out.
Yeah.
So that's why he goes to the huddle.
He said, "I entered by hardly placed foot in the door before children shrieked and one woman fainted. The whole village is roused. Some fought. Some attacked me until like then he just ran."
To look like this, and he didn't start like actually referring to himself as like a real monster until like 90 page like 97, and he's like talking about like the monstrous things he wants to do instead of just having it appear that he wants to do things like that. He actually wants to become that role because people put him in that place. So he's like, if everyone's gonna judge me for the way I look, then I might as well act like the way I look.
Assume that I'm some terrible creature in that as well.
Act like a terrible creature, yeah.
Yeah, I think he hates himself just because he can't. Like, if you can't communicate what you're feeling, like, you're not human, and I think he knew that. So I think him hating himself was purely because, like, he knew what he looked like, and he couldn't tell people what he was like. So with both those things, like having a part in his life that just alienated him more, because if you can't say how you are on the inside and people just judge him on the outside, there's no way to be judged. So I think it was self-hate, and I don't even think he was sympathetic for himself, because I think he knew he could do it, and that's why he like had the drive to be knowledgeable, but I don't think he has sympathy for himself, just because I don't think he knows too much about himself at the point of the book that we're talking about. Like later I would say he has sympathy for himself, but I think now he doesn't. I think he just hates himself.
Yeah, I think it says like what you just said on page 85, where he's like, was I then a monster, a blot upon the earth from which all men fled and whom all men disowned? I just think he's kind of thinking that everyone sees him as a monster, but he doesn't feel like a monster. on top of that, like, he has, like, self-hate because of, like, the way he looks. And that's, like, relatable to, like, a high school thing, too, because, like, everyone can, like, hate themselves for, like, something that they see about themselves, like, because there's nothing you can do about it but hate yourself, even though it's technically not really your fault. So he kind of just, like, blames himself for the way he looks just because, like, nobody will give him a chance for the way he acts.
He blames his creator, like, the
time. Yeah, but he, like, hates himself at the same time because he calls himself, like, unworthy, like, all the time.
I think he, like, he hates himself so much because his own creator thought he was a monster. So I think, like, the person who means the most to you in the world calls you pretty much worthless and a monster. You don't really have any meaning to yourself. I think that's where he gets most of his self-hate from.
It also kind of seems like there's a reaction between the Enlightenment and Romanticism. Also, almost seems as if the Enlightenment is an antagonist, Romanticism is the protagonist, because the Enlightenment created this monster who looks bad, but was created by the doctor who was one of the Enlightenment at the creation, but he became this thing that looks disgusting, but he has very romantic values on the inside.
See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It almost seems neutral.
That's tough. Because he helped out the family, like, by bringing him firewood is a good example. Like, he does things that a monster wouldn't do. That's really nice, really kind, to do something that doesn't really benefit yourself in any way. But then at the same time, like, he's seen, nobody sees that from him. He does it secretly. Where I think if he did it out in the open, it would be viewed differently from the people in the town. I don't know exactly how it would be viewed, because to see someone, like maybe a criminal or something, someone you think is lower or a monster or a murderer, for example, do something kind, is shocking. Changes your perspective of them. So.
And I think, I'm glad you mentioned that aspect of the narrative, because one of the disagreements between the darker romantics and the more optimistic romantics, or the optimistic ones thought that we human beings were kind of inherently good.
my opinion. I think if she would have made him more of a monster from the beginning, that would have made me see more evil. But instead, it made him sound so innocent. It made him look so innocent. And these people constantly hating him. And for example, like the family he's helping so often, he gets shot by one of them. That's society like molding him rather than him just being a monster at first. So yeah, I think if he would have, or if Shelley would have like done something with Frankenstein right out of the beginning of his creation, and instead the monster tried to kill Frankenstein or something, you would kind of have a different intention. Because then society's trying to mold him to be good, but considering he's like a blank slate, they have to mold him in whatever way society does. So I think society's definitely the molder rather than just himself.
I like to compare Frankenstein to somebody that I personally know, my uncle. I know I talk about him a lot, but there's like, I could just remember some things that we talk about in school. And he just, I like to, like, he's a lot like Frankenstein. He just got out of prison for a very long time, and he doesn't know how to act in society. He's mentally sick. He says stuff, and he does these bad actions. Like, he'll sit in a dark room and not do anything. Some of the stuff that he says is just, so I don't really think it's society, because my uncle hasn't been in society, so he wouldn't know, but just like Frankenstein, and at the
you
same
mean the
time,
monster.
Yeah, I'm in stuff, this is, anyways, and yeah, what was I was gonna say?
I like what Anna said, but I think, you know, like, she's like, it relates to high school, like, how, like, he hates himself, like, there's a lot of high school students like that. I think, like, when we talk about his self-awareness, I could be like dead wrong here, but like, what if like people in like Frankenstein, who like suffer from like being like having self hatred, what if they're more self aware than people who are like really happy most of the time? Like people who are really happy, maybe they're ignorant to the fact like of stuff that people who are more self aware see. You know, you kind of know what I'm saying? Like people like who are really happy, like they see everything is great, and they're kind of ignorant to some stuff. And then people who may suffer from depression and self-hatred may see, like, they might be too self-aware or something like that.
Well, the whole high school thing, the only reason why you become discomfort with yourself is because of other people. I mean, if there is no other person, why would you notice your negative appearances?
Because you're really self-aware.
Yeah,
well,
because
yeah, other people.
Well, I don't think self-aware is, like, it's a word, like a good word to use, but I think self-critical is more important.
Yeah.
Because people who I think are more self-critical hate themselves more because they have higher expectations for themselves. But the people who are happier, I think they just hold lower expectations.
Mm-hmm.
Which isn't a good thing or a bad thing, so I agree
yeah,
with you.
Yeah,
like
yeah, critical is probably better. Where, like, you're going to take two people, like, one who's, like depressed and hates themselves. They get to look in the mirror and say, find, like, 50 things they hate about themselves. Like, if you took someone who's totally happy, they'd be like, yeah, I love myself, I love everything. But, I don't know. They'd be ignorant to the fact that there is stuff wrong.
So, like, is ignorance happiness?
I think so.
You want to know if something's wrong than if you're not comparing yourself to other people.
But the monster is comparing
yeah,
himself.
Yeah, I know. So, you guys can't say that it's like self.
Yeah, but it is. Because it's like,
because of other people, that's the way he is.
What we're saying is he's self critical because of that.
Yeah.
Because it's related to this big question. Let's go to what Joe wanted to talk about, language, and that was one of our five questions. I'd say these chapters, these 11 through 16, are really all about the monster becoming, right? Becoming and being, and developing a sense of identity or self-awareness in relation, in some way, in relation to how other people treat him. What role does language play in this process? Right. Especially in terms of the monster's understanding of the instinct in him and his own feelings of becoming. Joe, do you want to start us off?
When the Arabian comes to the village, like Felix teaches her, it was a girl, right, how to read and stuff. On page 84, it says, at the top, it says, my days were, this is speedily master the language, and I may boast that I improved more rapidly than the Arabian, who understood very little and conversed in broken accents, while I comprehended and could imitate almost every word that was spoken. While I improved in speech, I also learned the science of letters as it was taught to the stranger, and this opened before me a wide field for wonder and delight. So, he learns how to, like, read and write, pretty much, and then, also he learns, like, what the people, what makes the people happy and unhappy in the village, like, and then he relates that to himself, like, what makes him unhappy and happy, and it, like, kind of develops him, into knowing what a human is.
He got happy from what they did, and sad from what they did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then he related to himself, like, what happened to him.
So, in this book, we see a lot of cases where knowledge is bad, but in this case, when he obtains knowledge, he gives a lot more help. And I kind of was obsessed with this chapter too, because when he compares himself, he's like, the humans, and I think what Shelley's trying to get at is like, what separates humans from God, and what separates humans from animals, and so on page 78, in almost smack dab middle, it says, "I found that these people possessed a method of communicating their experience and feelings to one another by articulate sounds. I perceived that the words they spoke sometimes produced pleasure or pain, smiles or sadness, in the minds and countenances of hearers. This was indeed a godlike science." So I think he's saying here that it's a godlike science that animals can't replicate. Of course, now we know that, like, orcas and dolphins and a lot of animals. But I think they communicate differently than humans, I would like to think, and that maybe they didn't know it at the time. But I think it makes sense. And the monster, like,
I don't know where it is in the book because I can't find it, but there's, like, this one part where he says that, like, with knowledge came suffering, because he was, like, learning more about the people and how it didn't affect him, and how, like, what they could do, he couldn't do because they were actual humans and he was just, like, created randomly in someone's lab. And so I, like, disagree with the fact that he, like, became happier with knowledge, because he said it was, like, it was exciting for him to learn what they're like, but at the same time it was, like, hard because he didn't get to learn how they did, because he had to, like, learn in the back of a shed while this girl got to learn out in the open.
Is that page 85?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
What a strange nature is now. It clings to the mind as well as seized on it, like a light on a rock, and wish sometimes to shake off all thoughts of the world. But I learned that there was but one being. I'm a little obsessed with chapter 2. When on page 84, when the monster starts to gain literacy, the ability to speak, to write, or not to write, but to read, he starts to read. And from this reading comes a certain kind of knowledge that is really interesting, probably significant. He reads history. And he says, this is on the paragraph that feeds these wonderful narrations. "These wonderful narrations inspired me with strange feelings. Was man indeed at once so powerful, so virtuous, and magnificent, yet so vicious and base? He appeared at one time near some evil principle, and at another is all that can be conceived as noble and godlike. To be a great and virtuous man appeared by his honor and to fall sensibly. Base and vicious, as many on record have been, appeared the lowest degradation, condition more abject. suggest that humanity is, he's so confused because they can seem at one moment so virtuous, yet the next moment so horrible, so vicious, so base. Which one is it then? Who are we?
I wouldn't say that's what makes us human, because animals definitely have that side of them too, where like if you see lions, you know, the moment they're chasing down an animal to hunt and kill, and then that life, but then the next they're, you see them playing with cubs and like they're cute. So I think all living creatures have that, so thus I think so.
Great and virtuous man, like 1 second, and then be like base and vicious if someone like pisses you off. Like it's just a part of like what mood you're in.
Yeah, I think that's why it's so hard for him to understand. Is like, and this is why he's asking this question, because as humans, like you're taught to be like that. Like sometimes people are gonna have like bad days, or with him, he's not aware of this because he has no one to teach him. So I think the question you're asking is exactly why he's asking that, because he has no idea if there's one or the other. And I think through his experiences and through him getting shot, he realizes that there are two. That he realizes that you can be a virtuous man and be incredibly horrible the next minute. So I think that was his way of being ignorant, and then his experiences taught him to be more knowledgeable of that fact. So I think it's cool with this chapter especially, because like I realize that through these chapters it kind of reflects what I think it means to be human. Like the fact that we can speak and say what we're thinking, no other species can do that. So he learns how to do that. And then now he can talk about his own emotions and separate emotions. So now he also has that part. So I think as this chapter, like this chapter especially, it starts to show him becoming more and more human. That's why I think I got more empathetic towards him after every chapter, because you realize like he's learning this. So now that he's learning all of this, there's not much that separates him. Because him having all these personal experiences are teaching him. And I think that's the thing that he was deprived of, and he just doesn't know it. Because being created in a lab, because we don't obviously know how old he is, but he missed out on all of that. Like when you're born, you have a fresh new start. He has a new start, but so far behind everyone else. So I think that's a big thing.
He got off to a rocky start too, because
yeah,
everyone thinks he's pretty good.
Eventually he makes the distinction between physical pain and mental pain, or just being able to feel. He understands that feeling hot and cold is bad, it hurts, but then he has a distinction of mental pain, which doesn't really hurt, but it's just the way he feels. Like, first time in the book that I saw the monster, the creature, really feel some sort of emotion. He said, on page 75, he said, he pronounced a few sounds, and the fair creature, leaving her work, knelt at his feet. He raised her and smiled with such kindness and affection that I felt the sensations of a peculiar and overpowering nature. That is his first time actually feeling something. It seems to be like a good feeling, and it doesn't have anything to do with temperature or how he felt, hunger, nothing about that. It's only how he feels personally.
This is so cool, because I highlighted this part because it's talking about something indescribable, which is the whole idea of romanticism. It's talking about a feeling that he can't
final break.